Listening Library presents On the Wings of Heroes by Richard Peck. Read for you by Lincoln Hoppe. The Box Elder Tree. Before the war, the evenings lingered longer, and it was always summer when it wasn't Halloween or Christmas. Long, lazy light reached between the houses, and the whole street played our version of hide-and-seek, called only by Ollie Ollie Infree and supper time. Before I could keep up, I rode my brother's shoulders, hung in the crook of Dad's good arm. I rode them across the long shadows of afternoon, high over hedges, heading for home base, when our street was the world, before the war, when there wasn't a cloud in the sky. Home base was a branchy box elder tree in front of the Heiser's house out by the curb. We could count on the Heisers not to mind when we pounded in from all directions to tag out on their tree. We plowed their sod when we skidded home, bled all over their front walk when we collided, knocked loose the latticework under their porch. Big Cleve Runyon, who was 19 years old, lit once in the middle of their syringa bush in an explosion of sticks, and it didn't fill out again till after the war. But the Heisers had no kids and were getting on in years. They said they got a kick out of us. They were the rare grown-ups who liked noise. And Mr. Heiser was deaf. Nobody was a stranger before the war. Everybody played. Dogs, too, yapping at our heels. Dogs we didn't even know. They weren't locked up or walked in those days. They ran wild like the rest of us. Kids younger than I was were in the game, and big sweating galoots like Cleve. Kids from the other streets, and girls. Once in a while, dads, before they went to war or worked Sunday shifts. Always my dad. We played to win. One time, a big boy was it, Cleve or one of the Rogerses, and we took off for the alley to hunker behind the hollyhocks, my brother Bill and I. Our breathing was like dry leaves while a cracking voice yelled numbers into the tree. 5, 10, 15, 20! When we heard in the distance, "Here I come, ready or not!" Bill swung me up on his shoulders. We bobbed and weaved across a patchwork quilt of backyards from one garbage can to another. Like magic, Dad was there by the Heiser's back drain spout. In a Newt Rockne handoff, Bill passed me to him. I hung like a hammer off his belt. My feet danced in air. My head hung. There we came around the house. Dad, pumping and wheezing, panting and red-faced with his bifocals fogging. Car keys and change rang in his pocket. His timing was better than a kid's. Whoever was it never saw us coming, and it could have been Jinx Rogers, who played basketball on the starting five. I slapped the tree personally. One time, Dad dropped me. On a hot evening, I oozed out of his slick arm and did a cartwheel, landing across the rocks around the Heiser's flower bed. The air went out of me, but there wasn't time to cry. Dad scooped me up and ran to the tree. I took giant strides in the air just above the grass, and we tagged in with seconds to spare. Later, when I'd outgrown the crook of his arm, when Bill was away, Dad stayed in the game a little longer. He'd find another toddler to tote, or he'd erupt all on his own 190 pounds out of the Heiser's thrashing bushes and swerve toward the tree. His work shoes slapped the bricks of the street before he could get himself stopped. But he always let himself get caught if he didn't have a kid in his arms. "He's the biggest kid on the block," Mrs. Jewel Heiser said from her porch over the spirea, "that Earl Bowman." Smiley and Jewel Heiser were country folks who'd retired into town when Hitler invaded Poland. Mrs. Heiser had seen newsreels of refugees fleeing the Nazis along rural roads, pushing all their belongings in baby carriages. She believed the rumor that if we got into the war, there'd be no gas or tires. We'd all be trudging along on foot like the refugees. So the Heisers bought the second bungalow from the corner behind the box elder tree. There, they settled into their porch swing to await invasion. Mrs. Heiser said she saw World War II coming before Roosevelt did, way before. She'd never been easy in her mind since the Hindenburg blew up, which she said was a sign. She was a great one for signs and could describe the exploding Hindenburg like she'd been on it. Passengers burning alive, staggered on fleshless feet through its melting steel skeleton. Mrs. Heiser had a fine sense of doom and kept a scrapbook of clippings about automobile accidents and house fires. Her tales were always worth hearing again, unless you were my mom, who said once was all she needed. The Heisers played to a full porch for the one about a nephew of hers who'd skidded on his sled. He shot under an international harvester truck and scalped himself. They were living history to me, the Heisers, older than Dad. Mr. Smiley Heiser drove a 1930 Essex. Mrs. Heiser had played piano for silent movies before talking pictures came in. She played by ear, whatever that meant, and could render any song as long as it wasn't new. If you asked her for Chattanooga Choo Choo or Mersey Doats, she'd just look at you. But to show us what real music was, she'd spring out of the swing and slip indoors to her upright piano. We waited for the crack of her knuckles, then, "Yes, we have no bananas," or "Too much mustard," or "If you knew Susie," or even "Papa, get a hammer, there's a fly on baby's head," pounded out in the night. Both Heisers were musical, though Mr. Heiser was deaf. When they sang "Just a Song at Twilight" in close harmony, they held hands, which amazed me in people of their years. On hot nights, Mrs. Heiser remembered a boy cousin of hers who got lost in the blizzard of 1896 between the cow barn and the house. He froze nearly to death and shook so bad he bit off the tip of his tongue. "How did you get him to stop shaking?" somebody always had to ask. "We never did," Mrs. Heiser recalled. "We just tied him to the churn and made butter." We hung on her words and waited for the cackle of her laugh. She kept a lace handkerchief down the V of her house dress for wiping under her glasses because she seemed to be laughing or crying most of the time. "Get her to tell you about Jimmy Johnson and the corn picker again," Dad mentioned to me one night after supper. I didn't ask why. You could hear a pin drop whenever Mrs. Heiser ran that one past us. It was a ghost story, and she'd seen one.
"You want to hear that again?"
she said later on in the evening, closer to lightning bug time. Scooter was on hand that night, and the Bixby sisters, and me, naturally. We perched in a row on the porch rail under the hanging ferns. The story was about the early days of mechanized farming, when the tractor took over from the team and the motorized corn picker came in. The corn picker revolutionized farming, but it had a flaw. You wanted to be careful or it'd take your hand off. There was a generation of one-armed farmers because of it, so this was a story right up Mrs. Heiser's alley. Mr. Jimmy Johnson was their country neighbor down in Moultrie County. He was a good farmer, but slow to adapt to modern ways. He bought himself a corn picker, then lost a hand pulling stalks out of the snappers because he'd neglected to shut down the engine. She could make you see that ripped-off hand vanishing into the chomping corn picker. In some of her tellings, it wrenched the whole arm off at the shoulder, popped it off like a wishbone. Mr. Johnson had stood there in shock, watching the corn picker eat his arm along with his shirt sleeve and the button on his cuff. In all her tellings, blood went everywhere. Mr. Johnson left a trail of it up to the road, where he died in a drainage ditch. The Bixby girls clung to each other. Scooter's profile was freckled green chalk in the twilight.
Everybody turned out for the funeral, Mrs. Heiser remembered, and Mr. Heiser nodded. Will I ever forget Jimmy laid out in his coffin? The blacksmith carved an artificial arm to fill out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.